Good evening, everybody. I'd like to thank AMA for inviting me to give this lecture on surgery for obesity and metabolic syndrome. I presume this is the most controversial topic in the medical fraternity as of now. So, without further delay, let me go and clarify a few things which might be better off for the future in trying to deal surgically with morbid obesity and diabetes. The ugly truth, what is happening in the world. India is the third most obese country after US and China in absolute numbers. Second highest number of obese children after China. Second highest diabetic country in the world. Second highest hypertensive country in the world. Maybe by 2025-30 might overpower China in being the diabetic and the hypertensive capital. And of course, 28% of obese Indians have high risk of premature death. And 8% are morbidly obese with 78% increase in mortality, which is 40% in the West with 60% increase in mortality. With just 8% of Indians being morbidly obese, we have 78% increase in mortality. That shows how much metabolically compromised our body is. Then why we talk about bariatric surgery? It's the only proven life-saving modality when all other conservative measures fail. Again, this I reiterate, bariatric surgery is the treatment offered only if the conservative methods have failed to resolve or cure the comorbid conditions and not only weight. There should be a resolution of comorbid, non-resolution of comorbid conditions which need to be addressed. And again, as of now, we bariatric surgeons are being isolated, trying to fight the system which we like to want to change in the world because there's a lot of negativity going around in the world. There's a very interesting study in 2007 by Dr. Nicholas about the Caucasian population of more than, I think, 4-5 lakh people of morbid obese patients taken for surgery as well as another arm with medical management. A 5-year mortality is compared. Control with medical management had 6% mortality, only 0.68% mortality in patients who underwent bariatric surgery. So, just because it has a complication doesn't mean that bariatric surgery is inferior. It's more than 10 times better outcomes of life quality if you operate on morbid obese patients with comorbidities. What are indications? Severe or morbidly obese with comorbidities, failed medical management, poor quality of life, all has to be there. And non-morbid obese, uncontrolled diabetic patients also can be offered this. So this is a guideline given by our national organization, which is in line with IDF as well as IFSO APC organization. This is a principal cutoff for the Westerners. Normal range between 80.5 and 25. This is overweight between 25 and 30. 30 and 35 class 1, 35 to 40 class 2, and more than 40 is class 3 obesity. Whereas an Asian cutoff by International Diabetic Federation is because we have lean mass and we have more prone for more metabolic syndromes earlier in our career, in our life. So we reduced 2.5 points in the principal cutoff. We are eligible for obesity status the moment we cross 27.5 BMI. And class 1 is 32.5, and class 3 more than 37.5. At the end, when you talk about bariatric surgery, it works basically on three principles: restrictions, malabsorption, and satiation. So reduce less desire to ingest, decrease assimilation, and reduce ingestion. All three in combination or separately can be used depending upon the condition of the patient. We work on various principles. One is called a foregut theory. We all know ghrelin is secreted in the fundus of the stomach, which increases the secretion of intermediate group of hormones in the duodenum and the proximal small bowel. Whereas if you do bariatric surgery, the ghrelin is reduced, so there is reduced appetite causing weight loss and increased glucose tolerance as well, because the major stomach is removed and nutrients also passed rapidly into the proximal GI tract, increases the intermediate secretions. When there is a strong the foregut theory, we have three major options of surgery available. The most famous of them is sleeve gastrectomy, second common is Roux en Y gastric bypass, and the less common and not used nowadays is gastric banding because of its complications.
who are the candidates for this type of four bacteria? So severe morbillities, associated comorbidities, volumeters. That's very, very important. Volumeters, they perform well with four bacteria where restriction is much more common and who has a sedentary lifestyle as well. This is a typical illustration of a sleeve gastrectomy. What we do is we put in a 36-inch bougie, which is about the size of an esophagus, devascularize the greater curvature of the stomach, use staplers, and vertically transect the stomach. Make a stomach which is about 500 cc into an 80 to 100 cc vertical sleeve or pouch. So this is the future stomach. So the pressure is built up more here, transit is increased, undigested food particles go rapidly, causing increased ingredients. Ghrelin is removed, so there is not much of an anti-ghrelin effect, and a restriction causes reduced intake. All these three functions work for weight loss. What is the advantage? Just a simple technique, no major nutrition deficiencies, better patient compliance, excess weight loss of 60 to 70%. A patient who is around 30 kilos overweight can lose around 20 kilos. Resolution of comorbidities is 65%, but of course every surgery has its side effects. Complications of 11.3, of which major complication of a leak or obstruction is 2.5, minor complications of weight potatoes and nutrition complications, sometimes reflex and all those things. GID is one intractable problem what we normally face. 20% failure, that means 2 out of 10 patients fail when you do sleeve gastrectomy. There are chances of weight regain as well as sleeve gastrectomy because we basically go only restriction. When the patient starts eating more, starts failing the procedure, slowly stomach can increase in size, causing weight regain, 30% increase in weight regain in 5 years time. And this is one reason why Indians fail, one third of Indians fail a sleeve gastrectomy. This is a Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, which is again a very simple procedure where we go and do a small pouch. Once the small pouch is about 25 cc pouch, when the pouch is created, then what we go is small bowel is about some 5 to 7 cm, about 75 to 100 cm beyond the DJ flexure, transect the small bowel. The distal bowel is taken up and connected to the pouch, and the proximal bowel connected to the distal small bowel. So they do, when we do anastomosis here, so food enters through the esophagus into a small pouch of stomach and enters into the distal small bowel, distal jejunum. And the bile, the acid and the pancreatic juice comes down and joins beyond 150 to 200 centimeters to the distal small bowel. So this is a Roux-en-Y gastric bypass. It's for all type of eaters, excess weight loss of 85%, resolution of comorbidities also up to 85%. Long-term weight loss is achievable in this, and it also helps in metabolic syndrome, that is resolution of diabetes and other comorbidities. Complication is pretty similar to sleeve, but the major complications are much more than the sleeve, and that's why it is not as popular as the sleeve. With internal herniation is a complication which can cause be life-threatening. Failure is only 15% compared to 20% in a sleeve. Weight regain is 20% in 10 years compared to 30%. So the durability of procedure is much more. For the reasons, this procedure is of choice for patients with morbid obesity and diabetes as well for so long. A typical picture of a patient who has PCOD treated with sleeve gastrectomy. Then we have a Heinkel theory, where what happens is when the undigested food particle goes down to the distal small bowel, the L cells of the proximal colon secretes GLP-1 and PYY, and they reduce the appetite and improves glucose tolerance. So apart from your Forger theory, Heinkel theory also adds to it. These are the common Heinkel theory options, of which mini gastric bypass or one anastomotic gastric bypass is the most popular as of now. But duodenal bypass is very rare procedures now done. Candidates, uncontrolled diabetes is a very strong candidate. It can be done even for normal eaters, but patient has to be compliant because of nutritional deficiencies can be common in these patients. What we do in this mini gastric bypass is, instead of a small pouch like in a Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, we make a big pouch in this. Instead of a 25 cc pouch, we make an 80 cc pouch. Once you make an 80 cc pouch, the intestine is not transected. just taken in and a loop is anastomosed, which is about 150 to 200 centimeters, depending upon the weight of the patient. So this completes the procedure, and food enters directly into the distal small bowel. This we call as a more of a metabolic procedure. Advantage is simple alternative, comparable excess weight loss, like a hyaluronic acid bypass, better resolution of comorbidities, good patient compliance, and the least failure rate, only 5% failure rate in these patients. And then complications also is much lesser than both other procedures. Major complication is just less than 1.5% and minor is 7.6. Biliary reflux, because of a loop, the bile comes back into the stomach. Reflux of bile is the only issue which can be addressed medically if it happens. Nutrient deficiency is much more common because we do a lot of bowel bypass. Long-term results, only 18-year studies are available, whereas bypass has more than 40, 45 years study available. This is a typical case of patient who lost 110 kilos post minigastric bypass. And of course, we still try to fight the system, and we have been really watched closely. But the most interesting part which really helps us nowadays is the metabolic syndrome. We all know obesity causes dyslipidemia, diabetes, and hypertension by their own mechanisms. What we call as the enteroinsular axis, as I told you, ghrelin secretion, if it is increased, that increase a group of hormones called anti-incretins, that is a black line, which secretes in the proximal 80 centimeter of the small bowel. So if when anti-incretins are secreted much more because of ghrelin effect, what happens is delayed insulin response and impaired insulin action, causing diabetes and hyperinsulinemia. So if there is more, type 2 diabetes. If incretins are much more than anti-incretins, we have dumping syndrome. So if you do a sleeve gastrectomy, we only take the ghrelin out. So there is still anti-incretin group of hormones available, but because of the reduced ghrelin, reduced secretion of anti-incretins, causing metabolic effect as well. Whereas if you do a bypass, we bypass the proximal segment of small bowel completely, and anti-incretins are completely avoided of food contact. This way, it helps in normalizing plasma glucose. So this is what we call as a metabolic procedure, and we have a weight-independent resolution of comorbidities. Whether patient loses weight or not, patient can lose diabetes in these patients. And this is a typical patient lost diabetes, hypertension, and dyslipidemia post-surgery. And again, there are other mechanisms called gut microbiota. Lean body has a different interleukins, more interleukins, and I mean less interleukins and more mast cells, and a lot of adipose tissue also has a lot of things. And then in the obese patients, there is a change in the mechanism, more interleukin and more mast cells and more proliferation. Bariatric surgery completely replicates from this to lean mass. So there is a gut microbiota that plays a role. Lot of bacterial changes happens in obesity, goes back to the lean once the patient has bariatric surgery done. Bile acids, because of long follow-up of bypass, because after what happens is normally food chases the bile, here bile chases the food after bariatric surgery, causing disruption of intrahepatic circulation and critically assisted in gut microbiota, and also help in weight loss. And that's why there is a difference in the weight loss for individual patients because of the bile acids and the gut microbiota. Large-scale meta-analysis has proved bariatric surgery, irrespective of whatever treatment we're giving, is much more by surgery in treating comorbidities. At least around 75-80% with all the medicines available, still we are only 60% of resolution with comorbidities otherwise. The only thing is there should be nutritional consideration. Plenty of deficiencies can happen. B12, iron, calcium, B9, ADEK, sodium, bicarbonate, water, and protein. So proximal stomach and proximal small bowel has lots of nutritional deficiencies if you do a bypass. So for this reason, we have to be careful depending upon what technique we use. Replace these kind of nutrients. If we don't replace, patient will be very unhappy. Inadequate weight loss, nausea, vomiting, weight regain, all happens with nutrient deficiencies. There are plenty of experimental procedures that have come into the market. We put a band over a bypass, proximal jejunum bypass, we call SARI. These are all revision operations. Once the primary operation fails, we are experimenting all these procedures now. There is an Aussie National Registry that nowadays we have available. All over the country we have 11,000 surgeries done last year. More of sleep, second best is the mini gastric bypass, then the RVGP and others are 300. And it's a very interesting data of comparing bariatric surgery and gastric surgery with other surgeries. Any GA literature, complication of 17%, whereas our data is 7.4% and comparable with the international data of 8.7%. And mortality post-bariatrics is less than 0.3 in our national registry, 0.45 in the international registry, whereas the GA literature of any GA surgery is 3.15% mortality. So compared to any other GA surgeries, bariatric surgery has the least complication. But unfortunately, because of being in the limelight, it has been unfortunately wrongly portrayed, like what they portray doctors nowadays. Our data, we have done more than 1,080 surgeries in our center, excess weight loss of 74% in the last year, 76, resist of comorbidities is 81, total quality of life improved by 93%, complication rate is only 3.4% with mortality of 0.05% in our Apollo hospital. And that's the reality. Coming to resist of comorbidities, we have patients of 49% diabetes, 36% BP, dyslipidemia 45, hypergonadism 16%, 49% OSA, 25% arthritis, and PCOS 34%. Post-surgery, 86% resolution of diabetes without medications, 91% resolution of BP without medication, 78% of dyslipidemia, 100% sleep apnea being reduced, 71% reduction in arthritis, and 90% treatment of infertility. This is a huge difference in the way bariatrics can change. To end up, algorithm, if the patient is morbidly obese, if they have reflex, do a bypass. If they don't have reflex, if they're diabetes, go towards bypass. If there's no diabetes, go towards sleep. If they're sweet eaters, bypass, binge eaters, sleep, or volume eaters, sleep. That is the algorithm. And International Diabetic Federation has given surgical diabetic algorithm. In diabetes, if they are obese, class 3 obese, when the assessment is done, recommend bariatric surgery. Class 2, optimize the patient. If with poor glycemic control, recommend surgery. If good glycemic control, consider surgery, but still can be going through medications. Class 1, optimize lifestyle changes. With poor glycemic control, consider metabolic surgery. Good glycemic control, non-surgical. Non-obese patients, always non-surgical. That is the ideal guideline. And again, when we say all these things, we have been pounced upon by the from the world. But unfortunately, the truth is, this is the only option available for us. To conclude, bariatric surgery gives the best long-term weight loss and improvement in quality of life. Only modality available for long-term resolution of uncontrolled comorbidities. Mechanism of weight loss helps to choose the right bariatric procedure. Weight-independent diabetes resolution aids in ideal metabolic surgery. Multidisciplinary approach and referral system helps in long-term success. Of course, insurance and cost assurance can help patients avoid it. Thank you. Any doubts?
Liposuction common to bariatric surgery?
No, liposuction is what is called as a body contour surgery, to just shape the body. It doesn't do anything with weight loss.
Do a
clean operation. Okay, inflatable balloons are just a restrictive procedure where you put a balloon endoscopically. We have 6 months balloon, 1 year balloon. We have balloon which can be titrated. We can put 250 cc initially and increase. We had a lot of complications with balloon before. The present balloons, we have less complications because we put less amount now. When the patient is comfortable, increase every 2 months, increase the size for 1 year, which helps you to reduce about 10 to 12 kgs, around 40% maximum in a severe obese, 20% maximum in a morbid obese patient. So it can be a temporary measure or a measure for people who are waiting for marriage or for a holiday or something like that, but not a permanent solution. Any other questions?
The only complication is only nutritional deficiency.
No, nutrient deficiency is the complication which spoils everything. Like any other surgical complication of bleeding, infection, and leak in the GA surgery is always there. That is technically a wrong surgical approach that causes that complication. There are instances where increased pressure can cause a leak. Again, the amount of complications is much lesser than a GA surgical complication. But what spoils the patient is the nutritional complication, because the patient, like at the end of the day, they lose weight, but they're depressed. They are very weak, they faint, they have a dumping syndrome. These are all nutritional issues, sometimes inadequate weight loss. Everything can be nutritionally driven. Nutritional complication is the most difficult complication in bariatric surgery, which is completely sidelined, and we talk only about post-operative. If a patient has COPD, the patient has OSA, those patients have to be prepared well before surgery. But unfortunately, if you don't do that, then patient will have complications post-operatively. But again, that's all part of a wrong approach towards patient care. If those things are done properly, we have not lost a single patient. We operated on an emergency patient who came to the emergency with a respiratory arrest, tracheostomy done, patient not able to wave back. We operated those patients and made the patients survive. But a normal walking patient sometimes dies post-operatively. That is basically a poorly prepared patient that cannot come under a risk factor as such. For example, a cardiac risk patient can be a risk factor for a hernia, but cannot be considered as a risk factor for a cardiac surgery. Same way, when you talk about bariatrics, OSA, cardiac issues, or liver issues are all part and parcel of the bariatric surgery, so it has to be treated as a multidisciplinary approach. That is why we don't consider them as a contraindication for surgery. Yes, that's why we are experimenting a lot of new procedures. We have a new procedure called SASI, where we do a partial gastrectomy, where we have a 150cc stomach. We continue the normal pathway as well. We just take a ileum and anastomosis. So what happened, the nutritional side of the bariatric surgery is reduced now. Normal 25% of food goes through the normal passage, nutrition is absorbed. Rest 70% goes through their ileum. So transit, that hindgut theory helps in a big way. That way they lose weight, less of nutrient deficiencies. We are evolving. We are coming towards a procedure like what you explained. Eat better, still lose weight, and less of nutrient deficiencies. We might approach, maybe in a couple of years, those kind of ideal procedure.
Wait, 30% gain weight, sir, in the first.
Okay, sleep, because the stomach is reduced, and being elastic organ, patient fails the surgery, patient starts slowly eating more and more. There are some patients who might not, who might prefer to vomit by overeating. So they overeat and go to the toilet and vomit because they want to eat more. When they start doing that, stomach slowly starts increasing in size. Once they increase in size, the volume increases. So 80cc becomes 100, 120, 150, 200. Since this is a restrictive based operation, once the restriction is lost, patient gains weight. Yes, that is what. See, there are indications for each procedure. One procedure is not a blanket for every patient. It's not just a weight alone. Comorbid conditions, social status, their eating habits, their life skills, what work they do, which country they come from, what is their diet pattern. So much factors has to be taken into account before you choose what procedure. There are 8 procedures available. Sleep is eligible only for 20% of the patients. But unfortunately, we do sleep for 80% of the patients. That is where we end up with all these problems. When the right patient is chosen, we do sleep for certain specific patients, bypass for certain specific patients, mini gastric bypass. We choose this way. Patients are more happier with the less complications post-operatively and long-term weight loss. We have sleep patients with 14 years without weight gain. We have sleep patients who gained weight in 2 years. Same operation, same technique, same BMI, but patient fails the procedure. So that is what still we are not able to understand, but we tackle it by gastro. That's what we said. Where obesity is a mental disorder, which we're tackling it by gastro solution.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Raj Pandekar, for a wonderful talk. I request Dr. Srinath, please come, sir, and hand over the certificate of these sessions. See, we want to make